With a heart and personality of larger than life, it is indescribable to sum up who my father was in words. But to keep it brief, I will say my father was truly amazing. He could touch the heart of many with his charming and good-spirited energy, always having a positive insight and contribution to anyone's issue that he's addressing. I'm sure many would say, open quote, "I'm glad I met you. I didn't know that you knew that." That was what you would get from talking to my father. I know this because I see my siblings and myself as having the same effect on people. As they say, the apple don't fall far from the tree. My father was a well-rounded and in-touch individual. He never wavered to stand up for what he believed in, and he did so passionately, might I add. I learned a lot of things from my father, but one of the greatest things I learned, which is paramount today, is don't be afraid. That's why I'm standing here right now. That's why I'm addressing you people. That's why I flew here. Because this did make me scared, but I'm here. My father was very much a protector and a provider when I was growing up, and I always felt safe in his presence. So that, I feel I lost. The world as we know it can be difficult, but we as children have always felt protected. This experience called childhood and growing up may have had its moments and challenges, but if I had to do it all over again, I would be happy doing it with the same man I called dad, and I love and admired from ever since. I thank God for what he's put into me, and I will carry that good on in the rest of my life. Your beloved son, Greg. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Before I begin, I would like to play a tribute from my stepbrother, Julius.
Boy, Charlie, we miss you, but we all know you. And we know you just had to move on to the next project. Sometimes we get a higher calling we don't understand that just moves us on to the next phase of development. I take comfort in knowing that's what you are best at. There's no way to put into words the loss caused by the absence of someone so pivotal in your life. Charlie meant a lot to me. He showed me how to be a man, and he showed me how to be a husband. For this, I'm forever grateful. But above all else, I'm most grateful for the period of my life that you are a major part of. The word of God is made manifest through a very select group of hosts. If you're really still and you cut through the noise, you're able to feel his presence through his chosen few. I'm most grateful that I, like so many others gathered here today, were seen fit to be in the company of one of his chosen few, if even for a brief period of time. Because time is fleeting. It neither rests nor stops for no man, but memories are eternal and live on forever. My gratitude for your presence far outweighs my grief for your loss. Big up the link because it's strong same way. Farewell and best of luck on phase two of development, Charlie. Julius.
I love that. Okay. So, I want to acknowledge that though I'm strong, I'm not okay. So, bear with me. Ladies and gentlemen, family and friends, today we gather to honor and celebrate the remarkable life of my father, Charlie Hines. As I reflect on the cherished memories, profound lessons he imparted, I am reminded of the incredible legacy he leaves behind. My father was a man of extraordinary experiences and adventures. From his days flying planes, to racing car, to managing hotels and sitting on tourism boards, his life was a tapestry woven with tales of wonder and excitement. His stories were a joy to listen to, each one a testament to his adventurous spirit and his zest for life. Our talks were never dull or mundane. They ranged from sports, he was a sportsman, you know, to politics, he loved his politics, from business and industry to engineering and so many more topics, everything in between. My father was a man of principle, never hesitating to speak up for what he believed in. His honesty and integrity were unwavering. And while his delivery may have been a bit harsh at times, his intentions were always rooted in truth and sincerity. I will forever cherish the precious moments spent with my father during our daddy-daughter days. He would fly up from Jamaica and visit me in Miami, and our visits were, I mean, so much fun. And our favorite Chinese restaurant in North Miami Beach, I'll never forget it, that was our tradition for nearly two decades. We would go and sit and drink soup and eat food at this little Chinese restaurant. And it was during these moments my father imparted wisdom, invaluable wisdom and guidance, shaping me into the person I am today. Those moments were sacred to me and a time for us to bond and connect on a deeper level. My father was not just a parent. He was my first mentor, teaching me invaluable lessons about life, love, and the pursuit of happiness. Some of the lessons he imparted included the theory of relativity. Everything is relative. The theory of scalability. Everything small can be scaled proportionate to the ratio of outputs. He also taught me lessons about love and relationship, how a man should treat a woman, and how I should treat a man. Nobody body mop, Chrissy, he would say. And don't let your emotions overwhelm your intelligence. And everything is a game of chess. Everything is strategic. Even if you think, say, oh, it's not a big deal, it doesn't matter. No, somebody's strategy is at play. From my father, I learned invaluable lessons, and they've shaped my worldview and guided my actions. He taught me the importance of integrity and the value of strategic thinking and the power of resilience, and his wisdom and guidance were my first lessons in his lifelong mentorship, and I'm forever grateful for those insights. Anybody who knows my father knows that he loved Jamaica. Everything I know about Jamaica is built on the lens of significance influenced by Charlie Hines. Everything about who I am, how I show up in the world, how I respond, how I lead my business and career, all has to do with him and the inspiration he was and still is to me. I got the chance to catch up on some lost time growing up when I moved to Jamaica in 2017 to work for my father part-time and for a nonprofit part-time. When I first moved to Jamaica from Florida, there was a time where basically nobody in town knew my name, you know. I was simply known as Charlie Daughter. And literally people would call that name down the street, Charlie Daughter, Charlie Daughter. And I knew enough to turn around. I worked with my father at that time on several of his businesses as director of anything he needed. I'll never forget the suite or the living quarters he built for me in his house. It was the nicest, most thoughtful thing anybody had ever done for me. I remember standing in that room on that rug, and I bawled tears of joy that day because of the love I felt that my father had made a place for me, and it was so special. And he even built a custom closet in there with enough space for all of my shoes. I felt that same way again when he and my husband teamed up to build an adjoining room for my daughter when she was a newborn. My father and my husband got along incredibly well and had a relationship I even envied at times. My father was like a second father to him as well, which was strategic at first, I'm sure, so he could keep a close eye on him. But ultimately, they became peas in a pod, like father and son. My father was my protector. He always had a link or somebody to call with any situation. He was a problem solver, a creative genius, a way maker when there was no way anybody else could see. He would wait and think and figure it out and strategize to think of a way through. He was a dreamer, a bold thinker, an audacious leader, and more than anything, a visionary. My father's influence extended far beyond family, but into business and industry in Jamaica, providing mentorship and guidance to countless young professionals who respected him. And his passion for his homeland and nation building, job creation, and generational wealth was contagious. His vision for his future was inspiring. Everything I know about Jamaica is seen through the lens of Charlie Hines, and for me, his legacy will forever be intertwined with the fabric of this beautiful island nation, Jamaica, the land he loved. My father was not only a mentor and a guide, but a protector and a provider. He was a loving husband and a family man who cared and created a safe haven for me and our family, both financially, emotionally, physically, all the lees, ensuring that we always felt loved and supported. His ingenuity and resourcefulness knew no bounds. In closing, as we bid my father farewell, let us remember the words of wisdom he imparted and the love he shared. Though his physical presence may be gone, his spirit lives on in each and every one of us as a beacon of light guiding us forward. Rest in peace and power, Dad, knowing your legacy will endure for generations to come. Thank you.
Hello. Can anybody see me? Good morning, everyone. Again, thanks for coming. It's good to have your support at this time on honoring Uncle Tony. It's been a real hard time these last 6-7 weeks. As you know, grief comes in stages, so we've basically been through all of them 10 million times, but we're here for him today, and we're celebrating his life and his legacy. My first memory of Uncle Tony is when Nyasha and I were very young, maybe like toddlers, just learning to walk properly and running around the place, and he was showing us his house at Mountain Spring for the first time. And there was a very long, intimidating staircase that led up to the floors where the bedrooms were. And at that time, we were being carried up and down because mommy was scared of us falling down the stairs and breaking our necks. It was a valid point to note. However, one day, I was standing at the top of the stairs looking down and holding onto the railing. And I was wondering, I wonder if it's possible. Can I do it? But the stairs are so long and it's high. And then Uncle Tony turned the corner at the bottom of the landing and looked at me. And he said, Nadia, do you want to come down the stairs? I said, yes, Uncle Tony, I do. Can you come and carry me? And he said, no, man, you can do it. You can do it, just try. And I said, you sure, Uncle Tony? Yeah, man, I'm right here. Don't worry about it. I'll catch you if anything happens. It's fine. So he started walking up the stairs towards me, and I started to try to walk down. However, as you might know, I'm tall enough to reach the ground, but not that tall. And at that time, I was even shorter. So instead of walking down the stairs, I sat down, and I very carefully scooched to the edge, put my feet down, felt the carpet, yes, I can stand, and that's how I got down the stairs. Scooch, stand. Scooch, stand. And Uncle Tony was there encouraging me every step of the way. Yes, Nadia, you're doing great. Come on, baby, come on, you can do it. And I reached the bottom step, and he said, stand up, girl, stand up. And I stood up, and he was like, yeah, man, Nadia, yeah, man. And he picked me up and whirled me around, and I was like, yay. And then he took me out to where everyone was on the bottom floor and proudly announced that I walked downstairs by myself. My mother, of course, had a heart attack. But he assured her it's fine, I was alive. So that's my first memory of Uncle Tony. Encouraging, protecting, motivating, and just being an all-around wonderful person. Another vivid memory I have of Uncle Tony is when we were watching cricket. Well, he was watching cricket. I was walking back and forth and doing random stuff, and I noticed his intense concentration on this game, where all these men were wearing white and running around and getting dirty, and I was like, what the heck is going on? So I was like, Uncle Tony, what's going on? Why are you so intense? And then he put me on his lap, and he started to explain the game of cricket to me. And that was the beginning of a beautiful relationship with cricket, which really I should not have started, because now my heart is broken and I've been in mourning for 20 years, but we won't go there. Uncle Tony took the time to explain every little rule about LBW and the Duckworth-Lewis system. I'm like 6-7 years old, right? And he's explaining all the intricacies of the game. And I just grew to love it because of him. And I remember when I was older, like in my 30s, we're discussing the game, and he was talking about some point of note that was going on with a rule. And I reminded him that the ICC had changed a particular rule a few years ago, and I went through the details with him. And he was like, my girl, you know the thing, man, you know the thing. So that was another vivid memory. But I just wanted to say that for me, Uncle Tony has always been a father, a husband, a mentor, a businessman, a pilot, an engineer. He has been a provider. He has been a sports analyst. He has been a visitor when you just need someone to talk to. He has been a friend. We've always had a shoulder that you could cry on or talk to. And he took several secrets to the grave with him. Praise the Lord. So, in closing, for me, he was an integral part of my life. He introduced me to many things, not just sports-wise, but life-wise. When we visited his hotel, it opened up our whole worldview. We got to meet people from all over the world, and it really made an impact on us and our development. So we're here as well-rounded young women, in large part to my Uncle Tony. I'm going to miss his conversation. I'm going to miss his jokes. I'm going to miss him and just his presence. And I thank God that he made a commitment to Jesus Christ later in life. And he also learned the lesson of just holding on to Christ and just praying and letting God do the rest. He was an inspiration. I could see the change and the transformation in him personally when he became a Christian. And I encourage anyone in here who does not know the Lord to follow him and let him mentor you as well and become a Christian. I invite you to do so. It was the best decision for him, and it will be the best decision for you.
I'm going to start by playing something I sent to him, a voice note from his last birthday, and then his reply that will tell you our relationship in 15 seconds.
Good morning, Uncle Tony. Happy birthday. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Uncle Tony.
Hope you're having a good day. We love you. Bye.
Thank you, my special girl, but I think you better keep your day job. Hi to David.
He said, thank you, my special girl, but you better keep your day job. So that was my last time singing for Uncle Tony. Uncle Tony was more of a father to me than an uncle. I feel so blessed to have had him in my life. He and, of course, my mother made for formidable role models on hard work, loyalty, perseverance, service to others, and integrity. Uncle Tony taught me a lot. He taught me to dream big, dream audaciously, and to never stop believing that your dreams can come true. He was a risk taker, and he saw that trait in me and nurtured it. Sorry to say, Mommy, but many of our conversations started with either me saying, don't tell your sister, or him saying, don't tell your mother. As we then proceeded to share plans, dreams, information, stories, or anything else that we thought Mommy might question or try to talk us out of. He was a safe and listening ear, and I could count on him to give me real advice based in his rich and varied life experience, grounded in his love and protection, but also rooted in his optimism and his confidence in my ability to thrive. He and I bonded over our champagne taste, for me on a bare budget. And he always liked to see me dressed up with my hair done and looking, you know, all the way. So I appreciate the effort. Crystal, I love the thing. He would have loved that. Uncle Tony taught me to think critically and to be able to put forward my opinion confidently. He and I bonded over the enjoyment we took in thoroughly arguing our various points of view. Although Nadia was his favorite because she would just smile and nod and say, yes, Uncle Tony. He would often get annoyed at me because I, like him, like to win an argument. I also knew he was proud of that trait in me. In fact, I knew that I had done well when after a solid back and forth, he would just shake his head and say, all right, babes, all right. Or, I never thought of that. That was the biggest compliment. Along with my mother, I credit Uncle Tony from training me up from a young child to be fully confident in my voice and in my opinion, to not defer to others' opinions simply because they were older than I, a male, or for any other reason. I remember being in primary school and him asking me about, you know, whatever I was working on at the time, as much as an 8-year-old could work. And him not being satisfied until I could explain it in detail, tell him why I was interested in it, and explain it all to him. Uncle Tony may not have had any fancy letters behind his name, but he was one of the smartest people I knew. Anyone who underestimated him did so at their peril. Uncle Tony taught me to take risks, that it was okay to do something simply because I wanted to do it. One of my don't tell mommy memories is when I decided to get sister locks. Mommy was concerned because she was worried about how the hairstyle might impact my employability and things like that. This is back in the day before they were so popular. But I was really excited about it, so I called Uncle Tony to tell him, and he was initially hesitant, but I said, come over. I showed him the photos of people with the hairstyle and why I wanted to do it. And then he supported my decision and told me not to worry about mommy. She would come around, and she did. And then he said, don't tell your mother. And he gave me half of the money I needed to do the hairstyle. My other memory of him that I want to share is kind of related to the risk-taking and his adventurous side. I took my very first solo trip at the age of 24. In true Nyasha fashion, I decided that since I was going to fly to Los Angeles to be in a good friend's wedding at the time, why not just look into flying onwards to Australia? It made perfect sense to me at the time. The internet was in its infancy, you know, but Priceline.com had just started, and at that point you could bid on travel. And I found a miraculous fare from Kingston all the way to Sydney, Australia, with a 5-day stopover in LA for around $1,000 round trip. At the time, I was doing, you know, community work, and I had $500. I called Uncle Tony. I told him my plan. This is something I always wanted to do, Australia, and that I had found my fare. And he said, Australia? I said, I always wanted to go, Uncle Tony. And once he realized that I was serious and it was something I wanted to do and that I had a safe place to stay once I got there, he said he was proud of me for being adventurous, and he gave me the other $500. And I promise I'll take Nadia the next time I go. Uncle Tony taught me it was okay to treat yourself the way you would treat others. As a woman, so often we get taught by society to take care of others to our own detriment. Uncle Tony supported me when I wanted to splurge on something that wasn't essential, but that was within my ability to pay for. He and Mommy were a really good balance, as Mommy taught me to think before I spent, and he taught me that once I decided to spend, it was okay to spend on quality if it made you happy. Uncle Tony taught me it was never too late to find love. He was a ladies' man, as we all know, but he also knew quality when he saw it. And our last Christmas dinner together, I remember us laughing and telling stories and him saying that he had good taste in women. Rosie is a good example of that. and they were a perfect match, but all his women were pretty high quality. Seeing them together and seeing Uncle Tony so happy with her brought me great joy, and it also gave me hope in finding a loving partner for myself. Words cannot express how happy I am that Uncle Tony got to meet my fiance, David, and that more importantly, he approved of him. David is the first man I ever brought home that Uncle Tony never gave a hard time to. Those that knew him know that it's very high praise. Whenever he called me, he would ask about David. Uncle Tony is the only man I ever bought a Father's Day gift for. His love was an important part of my life, and I'm grateful that I had him. He stepped up for me and Nadia when the man who should have did not. And I'm grateful that we had this last Christmas together, that I got to cook a lovely meal for him, and it was ready exactly at 5 p.m. In our last real conversation over Christmas, I was able to tell him that I admired him, and God is really good, because it was just natural, unplanned conversation. Never thought it would be the last time we actually spoke at that level. But I was telling him that, you know, I admired him and how much he fought for what he thought was right. And I told him that I got that trait from him. And I can have peace knowing that he knew he was loved and that I know he loved me. My one regret is that he won't get to walk me down the aisle as I had planned to ask him. I wanted him and Mommy to walk me down, but unfortunately, that won't happen. I'm glad that we shared our faith in God, and I hold fast to the knowledge that I will see him again. I honor him with my tears and with my laughter. Thank you.
The hymn, "The Lord's My Shepherd." Please stand. Please be seated. We will continue with tributes from Mr. Earl Finnegan and Basil Williams.
Members of the clergy, members of the bereaved family, church congregation, good morning to you all. My association with Constantine Hines goes back to the late 60s when I was transferred from Clarendon College to the Dintil Technical High School, where he was a student. We were both boarders at the school and occupied nearby dormitories. He was a senior student and was feared by all new boarders based on his mannerism. In those days, most students had a nickname, and all new students were referred to as grubs. Constantine was called Docker. a name used only by his batchmates or a few others, certainly when he was not around. I made the cardinal error of referring to him by his nickname and experienced the full level of his displeasure. I had my nose plucked for several days. I had to clean his shoes on several occasions. And I was also denied the privilege of enjoying dessert of ice cream and jello at our Sunday meals, as I had to hand over my dessert to him. It was not wise to report the matter to the housemaster or any teacher, as this could lead to greater punishment. Constantine left Dintel at the end of my first year, and our paths did not cross again until later, when I worked at a bank in City Center, Montego Bay. He was then a member of the Jamaica Constabulary Force and was stationed outside of Montego Bay. We met occasionally, and I recall him saying that he would not be staying too long in the police force, as that job could not allow him to achieve his goals of being an independent and wealthy individual. In those occasional meetings, he made no mention of the ragging he gave me at school. Neither did I remind him of it. Our paths crossed again when I moved to Kingston in the early 70s and realized that we shared the same group of friends, except that everybody referred to him as Charlie or Tony Hines instead of Constantine Hines, which is the name I knew from school. As a result, I joined them in calling him Charlie Hines. The name Ernest, as appears on the program, just never came up at all. I'm just learning of it now. Charlie was a lover of football and a charismatic individual. He was a part of our group who attended almost every Major League football game at the National Stadium. We always sat together as a group in the lower section of the grandstand. Charlie had a very loud voice and could always hear him shouting instructions to the coach to replace a player that he thought was not playing well. Our instructions to players on the field, what they should do. He was frequently challenged by other football fans in the stadium, but being strong on his views, most persons would retreat or terminate the discussion so as to allow others around to enjoy the game. Charlie was instrumental in getting Carl Brown, famous Carl Brown, to coach Dintel football team. And I think that in that period, Dintel won the DeCosta Cup. He was a strong supporter of the school football team and provided sporting gears as well as financial assistance. I had the opportunity, by virtue of my job, to assist him in financing the purchase of a tipper truck. He never looked back since, and often mentioned that I gave him the start on his journey in acquiring several other assets. He was an astute businessman I recall when he visited, I recall that he invested in an apartment complex and nightclub on Cleveland Avenue, which was a popular spot for young professionals, particularly bankers and Air Jamaica employees. He later invested in a hotel in Miranda Hill in Montego Bay and was also involved in a bus transportation business. He was always looking for new business to enter into. Apart from owning his dream car, a Porsche, which in those days was a big deal, I suspect there are many other achievements which others here are better able to comment on. I extend sincere condolences to his family and friends, who are as shocked as I am on his sudden passing. May his soul rest in peace and light perpetual shine on him. Rest well, my friend Docker. I can now call you by that name without any fear of rejection.
Morning, appreciating ministers, family members, and friends. I've known Charlie for the better part of about 40 years. We have many stories and experiences that we promised each other we'd keep most of it between ourselves. It's my honor to offer him a tribute. You were a force of nature, a whirlwind of emotions and adventure. We held our breath as you faced impossible tasks and odds. Your ability to navigate treacherous seas, scale metaphorical mountains, and succeed when it seemed most impossible. Charlie, you are the embodiment of resilience. When life deals its cruelest blows, you stood tall and faced it head on. Your passion at times made you real. We saw ourselves in your struggles, your determinations, victories, and your quiet moments of introspection. Constantine Hines, affectionately called, of course, Charlie, my friend, my brother. For those who knew Charlie, or who knew him well, knew his strengths, and I echo the other folks who were here before me. He was an avid sports fan, strong debater, very knowledgeable, again, on international affairs and so many other areas. I can recall the many times we would meet for drinks, lunch, or just to catch up on so many issues and challenges that we both may be facing or want to bounce thoughts off each other. He would at times, of course, when we would go out for lunch or drinks, be correcting the server's performance, whether it be improper setting of the silverware, pointing out to her where the knife should be, where the fork should be, and the type of silverware that should be used. It's not that he was critical, but just to offer help in improving the service or product with that particular business place. I distinctly remember when he met his wife, Rosie. I had a small role in that meeting. We went to a party in Robins Bay some years ago. And of course, when we walked in, the norm is to scout, walk from one end of the party to the other, just to see who is there and any prospects. And then go to the bar, grab some drinks, and find a comfortable spot. So after a few drinks, I decided to, you know, hey Charlie, let's move again. And he said he was not moving. I said, why not? He said he saw someone that he had to meet. I said, okay. So, of course, I moved on. And went away for maybe about 10 minutes, came back, he was sitting in the same spot. I had to go get him his drinks because he's not moving. So I asked him, did you introduce yourself? He said, no. I said, why not? He just didn't have the courage. So I grabbed his hand, took him over, and we met Rosie. So we both introduced ourselves. So I left them to, you know, make small talk. And of course, 12 or better years, she's now Mrs. Rosie Williamson Hines. Rosie, that was a good meeting. Now, I would like to say Charlie was extremely special. He was warm. He may have been at times a little aggressive. And maybe it would seem offensive, but he meant no harm. It was his will, passion, and determination just to succeed, as well as get his point across. He was a true friend, could be counted on. We have, again, many secrets between us. So here's to you, my friend. May the stars remember your name. May the winds carry your spirit to distant lands. Farewell, Charlie. Walk with my friend.
Thank you. Members of the clergy, brothers and sisters all, good morning. I am attempting to do a remembrance for Ernest Constantine Hines. This is easily the hardest thing that I'll ever have to do. I hope to get through this by the grace of God and your prayers. I'd like to invite you on a journey with me as I try to take you through the different stages of my larger-than-life brother's life. I know many of you sitting here know him as Charlie, but many of us know him as Tony. You see, our origin is the rural poor, and most of us have pet names. Tony happens to be his pet name from birth. That's just by way of an explanation for the multiple names. I'd like to take you back to early childhood. He was a very happy and outgoing child, catching crayfish in the river, going diving in the deep side of the river, and playing marbles. And this time of year, kite flying would be high on the agenda. Not sure how many of you would be familiar with the gig, but that's something that they used to participate in a lot, playing of the gig. Cricket would be played with a coconut bowl and a silver orange ball, but they really enjoyed the game with these makeshift tools. I remember that the boys used to make a wooden cart, which they would quite often take on the road. Tony was told not to go on the road in these carts. However, many times he found himself in the cart on the road. Of course, when it was discovered, usually it's when he comes home with bruises, he would be punished. But you know something? He was always my protector, always. No one could trouble me when I was growing up. I remember a girl who once tied a dead lizard. She knew I was afraid of lizard, to a piece of string and chased me. I was so scared because I knew I could not outrun her. Then out of nowhere, Tony appeared. What do you think you're doing? Left her alone. Of course, she disappeared and I was safe again. I couldn't close early childhood without mentioning his love for cornmeal porridge. This love carried over into adulthood. We used to have some great times as well at our Sunday school picnics. I can still remember Robbins Bay and Mansion Hill. There would be games galore. At the end of the day, we would be totally exhausted, but happy. Early childhood was spent in Norwich District, and after our father died, in Fellowship. It was from Fellowship Elementary that he got a full scholarship to Dinthill Technical. After Dinthill, he went into the police force. I can't recall for how many years, but I know it wasn't for very long. He worked at the Ministry of Housing after that, and then he used to play music at parties. He then went into the trucking business, as you heard before, then construction. Then he went into cane farming and was also involved in the taxi business. Finally, the hospitality business. His working experience, as you can see, covered a wide field, and he had a good grasp of quite a few areas. He was a visionary. I never heard him verbalize the saying, what the mind can conceive, man can achieve. However, that's how he lived his life. He never gave up. When others thought his plans were not achievable, he would double down and push towards his goal. No matter how many times he stumbled, he would rise and start again. He spent a few years living in Florida, and while there, he tried his hand in the restaurant business. He was also president of the Florida chapter of the Dintel Alumni Association. This was just in keeping with his personality to be active and involved wherever he was. Tony had exquisite taste. Anyone was with his office or the hotel when he operated or his home can attest to that. He never used a professional decorator, but everything screamed professional. His exquisite taste also extended to his taste in women. He was also a very good cook. I wonder how many know that he had a very soft and emotional side. Many years after Mama died, he was sharing with me how sorry he was that she died before he could do something for her, look after her, basically. He said she went through so much after our father died that he really would have liked to, you know, have been able to help her. Would you believe it? After so many years, the tears started to flow. And when we learned that our brother Winston was in the hospital in England, he took the time off and went to see him. All those who knew Tony well knew that his bark was much worse than his bite. I know that he has helped a lot of people along the way. He was always generous with practical help as well as advice. He was an unrepentant and loyal comrade, not blind though. If he thought they were on the wrong track, he would not hesitate to say so, but never believed in washing dirty linen in public. He loved politics, not just party politics, but international politics as well. He had a short fuse and would often blow his top, but he never held a grudge. Once he said his piece, that was the end of it. He had a passion for sports, as you have heard before, a real passion for sports. Cricket, football, track and field. I will really miss him with champs and Olympics coming up. At the Olympics, when one of our athletes mined gold or broke a record, and my telephone rings, it's either my friend Claudette or Tony at the other end. When it is Tony, the excitement in his voice was palpable. I know he or she could do it, man, I know it. I've always been watching. That girl or that boy, depending on who it was, male or female, I'm just happy that he or she finally did it. He hated injustice and would always be an advocate. If he perceived it to be directed against him, he would not hesitate to use the court system. On a more serious note, a passion of his that he spoke about very frequently was that he wanted to build a skills training center in Norwich so that the young people could get some skills training and improve their life. He said he would name it after his mother. You see, he always was a mama's boy. I was a daddy's girl, so we were even. Loyalty was a dominant feature of his personality. If you were his friend or his family, you could count on his loyalty. I should add that he had some workers over the years who were very loyal to him and he to them. He was loved, not just by me, but by his entire family. We loved him just the way he was, with all his imperfections. If anyone has any doubts about this, just look at all the members of his family who came from England, the US, Bahamas, Cayman, and Portland, just to say goodbye. With the psalmist, I'd like to say, what is man that thou art mindful of him, or as my mother would say, man a plan and God a pull. May I end by sharing the last conversation we had 8 days before his death. He called me and was very optimistic about his business, said that things were about to take off, and he was just dying to have things going so that he could pay off all his debts and just live. He said he was tired of the stress, and it was just the grace of God that was keeping him going. That every day he gives thanks that he didn't have high blood pressure or diabetes, despite all that he was going through. He then asked me, by the way, what are you going to say at my funeral when I die? Taken aback by the question, I said, you want me to tell you what I'm going to say when you die? He laughed and said, yes, man, tell me. I replied, sorry, you'll just have to wait till you die to hear. If only I had known, I would have asked him, what do you want me to say? My dearest brother, I'll miss the booming voice, the infectious laughter, and even the vigorous complaint when you were invited to a 5 p.m. dinner and at 5:30, the food was still not on the table. Me hungry man, you shouldn't tell me 5 o'clock if I'm not 5 o'clock. Always a stickler for punctuality. The sound of the vigorous debates that punctuated the silence of my usually very quiet home will be missed. There will always be a void in my heart, and I will always love you. He has left behind his wife Rosie, whom I know he loved very much, his children Angelo, Gregory, Andre, and Crystal, grandchildren Michaela, Michael, Salija, Matthew, Emmeline, Aurora, Azuri, and other relatives and friends. This is not in my written thing, but I think I'd like to say he was a letter writer par excellence, really par excellence. When he writes a letter, whether it be to do with some dispute with a utility company, or a company, or an individual, or a finance company, it's well written, very explicitly expressed, quite often looking as if it were written by a lawyer, maybe because of his frequent interaction with lawyers and courts, he picked up the language, but all I can say, he was really very good. Take your rest, my dear Tony. May your soul rest in peace, and may light perpetually shine on you. Thank you.
During this singing of the next hymn, When Peace Like a River, an offering will be received in aid of the Bethel Baptist Church Mission and Development Fund. Remain seated until we get to the final stanza, then we will all stand together. The hymn, When Peace Like a River.
Yeah.
Let us pray. Loving God, Lord of life and death, we praise you that all people are made in your image and held under your care. We praise you that we are made to need each other's love and so reflect your truth and life. We thank you for the life of your son, Ernest Constantine Hines, for the love and mercy he received from you and gave to us, his family, friends, community, and nation. Above all, we rejoiced in the gift of your love in Jesus Christ. Receive these gifts as tokens of our thanksgiving to you for your goodness to us, especially that which we experience through Mr. Hines, your son's life. Use it to continue to spread your compassion, especially to those in need. This we pray through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forevermore. Amen. Please be seated. Let us continue in prayer as we offer prayer for his family. Let us pray. Eternal God, God of the living and the dead, trusting that your compassion bears all our burdens and gives us strength beyond ourselves, we place this day before you, the family of your son, Ernest Constantine Hines. Those grappling with his loss, the loss of his life, whose need now is greatest and whose pain is deepest. We ask you to look with eyes of compassion on his family, his wife, Rosemary, his daughters, Crystal and Angela, sons, Gregory and Andre, sister, Becinta, grandchildren, members of the extended family. We pray that you will draw all of them into the warm embrace of your love and mercy. We pray that they may experience your gifts of grace. Give them hope for sorrow, salve for pain, light for darkness, peace for troubled hearts, faith for the future. May they find your strength and comfort in each other and through the bonds of extended family and friends. May they find comfort in the gifts of grace and the joys of the memories he leaves behind. Above all, may they find comfort in the knowledge that he is with you in your kingdom, where there is no pain or sadness or loneliness or disappointment. Lord, remembering your son Ernest Constantine Hines with gratitude and celebrating his life and deeds, we also give thanks for all whom we love who have passed from our sight into the joy of your heavenly kingdom. We pray that you will keep us united in one holy and joyful fellowship until, at last, all shall be gathered up in Christ and the whole universe shall praise your name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray. Amen. Let us hear the word of God as it is written in the Old and New Testament. Readings from the Book of Lamentations by Jacqueline Wong, niece, and 1 Corinthians by Nathan Woods, nephew. That will be followed with a special musical item from Take Two, a group from the Bethel Baptist Church, and then God's messenger, Reverend Dr. Michelle Richards, will bring the word from the Lord.
Good morning, church. The reading is taken from Lamentations 3, verses 17 to 26, and I'm reading from the King James Version. And thou hast removed my soul far off from peace. I forgot prosperity. And I said, my strength and my hope is perished from the Lord. Remembering mine affliction and my misery, the wormwood and the gall. My soul hath them in still remembrance and is humbled in me. This I recall to my mind, therefore I have hope. It is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed, because his compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, saith my soul. Therefore will I hope in him. The Lord is good unto them that wait for him, to the soul that seeketh him. It is good that a man should both hope and quietly wait for the salvation of the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Good morning, everyone. My name's Nathan. I'm Tony's nephew. I'm going to be doing a reading from Corinthians chapter 15, verses 51 to 58. Listen, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed. In a flash, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. When the perishable has been clothed with the imperishable and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that in your labor in the Lord, that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. This is the word of the Lord. Thank you.
with trials and temptations. Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord, the Lord in prayer. Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord.
The Lord. Come on, let's bless the Lord in this place today. I think that really deserves a round of applause. Let's take it. Come on, somebody. Let's take it to the Lord in prayer. I am not as disciplined as I ought to be in the pulpit, so I asked for a mic that I can hold in my hand because I like to move around. And if we know anything about Charlie Hines, he was the biggest mouth in the room, and he would be moving around whenever you see him in any place. So we don't grieve as others grieve. When we think about our family members, our friends, our relatives, can you hear me from this one? Is it on yet? All right, just tell me when this one is on. On that side, I believe that Charlie is in a better place. You see, Charlie was a regular attendee, and I would say a member of Christ the Rock Community Church, which he attended for many years when he would visit or when he was in the United States of America. And from the outpouring of love and the support from Bethel Baptist, I know that he has been a very major support for that ministry as well. And so I'm grateful this evening. I'm grateful this afternoon that I'm here to stand to talk about this man of God, a person that I've known. And yes, I'm dating myself for over 40 years, that I've been a very important person in my life, in my travels, in my success as a minister, a friend, a confidant, and someone that I would say, even when there's an argument, and we know Charlie would hold on to his end of the bargain, once I give him the eye, he would say, all right, Michelle, what you say? So I know it's hard, it was unexpected, but we believe that his life, based on what I'm seeing here today, is a testament of the life that Charlie Hines lived. You know, we could have been otherwise minded. We could have been at the supermarket, at the beach, but we chose to be here today to support his family and to give our love and support for, you know, every person that's here. I'm sure that Charlie has touched your life in some way, shape, or form in his journey in life. And so I had a conversation with Crystal, and I told her that I spoke at my dad's funeral in 2019, and Charlie walked up to me and said, boy, I saw your bud. You have to go preach at my funeral. Here I am. And so today, I want to talk again about the dash. And the reason is, a lot of times we don't take the time to recognize our lives and how we live our lives and how it is that we go about our daily routine. You see, Charlie lived for, and Google helped me on this one, 27,978 days, 76 years, 7 months, and 6 days. Think about it for a minute. And so, when you get a chance, I want you to do the same thing. And to the date that you're Googling, think about what it is that you have achieved. Think about your walk with the Lord Jesus Christ during the time that you're here on earth, because we all know that tomorrow is not promised to anyone. So that's Charlie's dash. And that is, of course, the time between you're born and the time between you die. And to many of us, it seems so insignificant on the program, on your headstone. But if we stop to think about that dash, it is very important, or the most important part of your lifespan. It does not or should not be misunderstood for our own. The one thing, though, that we have are choices, which includes whether we go to the left or the right, whether we choose Jesus or we choose the devil, whether we choose heaven or hell. And that's just the plain truth. You see, dash could mean how we run, whether fast or slow. It means the straight gate and narrow way, or broad gate and wide way. And so just take it for a moment that I'm going somewhere with this. It was December 2002 that I promised the Lord that I would get baptized, and on May 2003 after my wedding. But I was celebrating my honeymoon in Hawaii. However, after I returned from my honeymoon, I found out that I was pregnant with my second child. I was so happy. Then we realized, the doctor and I, that I was losing the baby. But God would not have it that I would die. My promise to him, as I was lying on that gurney in the Plantation General Hospital in Fort Lauderdale, is that I would serve him for the rest of my life, because I heard an audible voice. And I looked up and I made a promise. And the Lord was speaking to me. And I started to repeat Psalm 121, which is the psalm that we're going to go with on today. And in that moment, one of the first persons I saw in the hospital as I opened my eyes and I was repeating Psalm 121 was Charlie Hines, standing over my bedside and praying for me that I would not die. So it would be remiss of me not to be here today standing, because he was one of the first persons that was there when I'd made that conscious decision to serve the Lord for the rest of my life. And I think that deserves a round of applause for Mr. Charlie Hines for who he is. So I had an ectopic pregnancy, and when I got out of the hospital, I decided, you know, with the help of God, that I would serve him. The long and short of it, I did not realize until recently that that was a psalm that my dad had given me several years ago. We never really discussed the Bible, my dad and I, but Charlie was like a dad to me in my life. And you know, the funny thing is, I just realized recently his age. Because if you know anything about Charlie, even past 25 years old, his thoughts, his lifestyle, full of joke, he's always that young person in the room. So I want you to join me today as I read Psalm 121, which is the psalm that I will be going with on today. Because we know that it says in Psalm 121, you don't have to stand. I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. He will not suffer thy foot to be moved. He that keepeth thee will neither slumber nor sleep. Behold, he that keepeth Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. The sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. He shall preserve thy soul. Come on, somebody. He shall preserve thy soul. The Lord shall preserve thy going out and thy coming in from this time, even forevermore. The long and short of it, I could not understand why that psalm, but today I truly do. I really, really do. Charlie and I had our moments, but the one thing I would say is that we always ended up agreeing, because he was there for my family and I in financial times, in emotional times. I met Charlie through my sister Carla. But he was more than just a friend to me. You see, my dad wasn't really in my life as much as I wanted him to be. So whenever I would find someone that could fit that role, I would latch on to them. And Charlie Hines was one of the few people that I could say that I really could latch on to. This psalm has kept me for many years, and I pray that even as you hear me at the sound of my voice today, that psalm is a psalm that you will go back and you will read it and you will understand what that psalm is saying, because that psalm is very, very profound. I remember one particular day, Charlie came and picked up my mom and I, and we went to a meeting in Duane Park. And he saw that my mom was very sad and said, "Mommy, what happened to you?" And she said, "I don't have Michelle's school fee." Charlie looked at mom and he said, "Michelle, I forgot school." At that time, I was attending CAST, now University of Technology. My mom never had to cry, never had to worry, never had to think about where that school fee would come from. You see, we have to look to the hills from whence cometh our help. Our help cometh from God. But God will always place that person that we can look to. And one of those persons in my life was, and I will still remember some of the wisdom of Charlie Hines. And I know that many of you here, as you're sitting here at the sound of my voice, you're here because you remember the wisdom. Come on, somebody, the wisdom of Charlie Hines. You see, Charlie realized how wise he was. I heard everybody talking about his love for football, well, soccer, his love for helping others. I know one school that he helped was Dintil. And it was just not anything for him to hear that someone is in need. And if he could help, he would definitely take the time to help. He was such a great person with helping others. And I know many of us here today can sit down and think about the things that he has poured into, how he has poured into our lives and how he has helped us. In 2019, when he told me that I would have had to preach at his funeral, you know, many times we say these things and we brush it off because we're a joke, you know. And when I was at that meeting on January 20th in Miami and I got the call, the first thing that came to my mind was, oh my God, I'm heading to Africa. And Charlie, was just not that one friend. But even as I was on the mission trip, because I just came back from Africa, for the 3 weeks that I was there on the mission trip, I was thinking about Rosie's wife, Crystal, Gregory, Angela, his family, every person that's connected to him. And I'm saying, God, how can I help this family with a word of comfort? Because you see, Charlie was that person that would give a word of comfort, especially in times of bereavement. My mom passed in 2 years ago, a year and a half ago, and he was there at the funeral to stand with our family. And so I want you today to just think about how much you're serving God, because nobody could have told Charlie on January 19th that January 20th would be the last day that he would be have his eyes opened. Nobody, because we know he's always a positive person. He's a confident person. He's a bold person. And it's hard for me to say was. So bear with me. And so I'm here today, and I won't be before you too long because I know it has been a long day, to remind each and every person at the sound of my voice, think about how you're living your life. Think about your life with Jesus Christ. Think about the fact that you'd want to see Charlie Hines again. We heard the scripture say, he does not get weary in his well-doing. Or Lord Jesus Christ doesn't get weary. I don't think Charlie ever got weary in his doing good for many of us as we're sitting here on today. In the midst of what we're going through, we must understand that the Lord is with us. He is our keeper. We all came here this morning in a car, some way, shape, or form that we came here, and we had no incidents or accidents because we know the Lord is our protector. Verse 5 says, the Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. Many of us know the strength is for most of us on the right side, and we can rest under his hand knowing that God is with us. The Lord shall preserve thee from all evil. My God, these promises are so true. Think about how many times people have come against you. Situations have come against you, but the Lord continues to keep us. I'm telling you, he will preserve our soul that is not to be defiled by sin and destroyed by affliction. Many of us are going through sicknesses and diseases, but we have to understand that he will preserve us from punishing eternally. He will keep thee in life and up until death. We have a good feeling that Charlie, I know, is in the arms of God. You see what Charlie did with his dash? He poured into many industries around the world. He blessed families. I know for sure one school that he poured into, as I said earlier, Zintil. He fathered some beautiful kids. And yes, you know, we know Charlie was a girl's man. We're not going to hide and talk. Love the ladies. And so he poured into so many of us as women. And one of the most, as I would know many of you know, argumentative voices that was very well bred and very smart. And we know that Charlie loved life. He loved life. And so I want you, every time you remember him, just think about when he would hug you and that he would do in your ear. I don't know if anybody know that he would do in your ear, when he loved somebody and he hugs you. And so that's all I can remember sometimes, is that in my ears when he would hug me and he would say, boy, Michelle, I just love you. He was a stalwart in Jamaica. That's all I can think about him for the time that I was living here in Jamaica and the experiences, the hotel industry, the transportation industry, the petroleum industry, and many industries that he has poured into that we don't even know, because he would do things that people would not even know. And long after, when I have an argument with somebody, must say, you know, sir, me did this and you know, sir, me did that. But you didn't know when he was doing it, because he would do it in confidence, because he was doing it from his heart. And so I want us to take a page out of his book today to know that whatever it is that we do, we must do it from our heart, because I'm a true testament. I remember when I moved to the United States and I started at Bank of America, and I started as a personal banker. With 2.5 years, I became vice president of mortgages at the bank. And Charlie was so proud of me. He was coming to the bank one day and he said, him come to make a lodgement. So the tellers are looking at him like, what is a lodgement? I want to put my money in the bank. And I'm sitting there and Charlie's like, oh, them not understand. No, you're making a deposit, Charlie. But that was him though. And he made make up a nice and the bank. I said, Charlie, come. But when I got promoted, he was so proud. And that is him. You know, it's not very many people I can say, yeah, put a dollar in my mother's hand, put a dollar in my sister's hand, put a dollar in my hand to say, go to school. But this one I can say. In 2008, when I said, okay, the Lord has told me to go into full-time ministry, he never to understand that one. Like, full-time ministry, you sure, Michelle, you? Because, of course, as you see, I'm a stay, love the party and the ting, ting, ting. But God has kept me with people like Charlie who would be there. I remember last year, that we went to a restaurant, some Chinese restaurant here. The food was so good. And, of course, Charlie was there with us. And Charlie Motor is the biggest promoter. You know that, Rosie, right? Around the table. And my friend, every time I was trying to argue, my friend go, because him know, say, listen, don't even try to match this person in an argument. As I close today, I want you to remember that he believed in people. If he would hear you with a dream, he was not a dream killer. He was a true, I heard someone say it and I agree with it, he was a true visionary. And so I believe that Charlie was certainly hearing from God. Because if you think about all the different industries, his resume, his bio, Switzerland, the different places that he went to study, different industries, I don't know how he did that in 27,978 days. Because many have lived so many more days than that and have not touched the surface of the industries, of the people, of the that Charlie Hines have touched. I want you to be interactive today as I close, because I'm so thankful today that God is such an awesome God. Every one of you sitting here should by now be thinking again, by now, of your dash. Just take some seconds and think about the day you were born and to the day that you are now. You and you and you and you and you. Every one of you, I'm telling you. So because it's never too late to live your dream. It's never too late to serve the Lord Jesus Christ. It's never too late for us to have a vision. Finally, the Lord, who is our preserver, is our comforter, shall abide with us forever. Let us be found in our work assured that the blessings promised in the psalm are ours. In your dash, you're living in unforgiveness of many of us, hurt, pain, rejection, afflictions, and infirmity. But as the acronym of dash says, D is divine power of God. We must walk in the authority of God, and that's the A. So we don't walk in sin, so we can live happy in the Lord whilst doing his will. This psalm gives us hope, which is the H. And in that hope, I want you to be happy. Because if you know anything about Charlie Hines, he was a happy person. No matter what it was that he was going through, he was always a happy person. The hope that we have is the hope in God. And so today, I want you to just have that hope in God and be happy. So we walk in the divine power of God, in his authority. We sin not, and we have hope. While we understand that we all have that dash that we are living out now, we have to be obedient in God. There was a man called Jonah who the Lord told to go to Nineveh, and he decided he wanted to go to Tarshish. And where did he end up? In the belly of a fish. Don't be fooled today that we can stay in that belly, in the belly of the fish. So we need to know. Don't wait until we are spat out. Now that you have hope, I want you to think about it. Then there was Jairus' daughter, as I close, who the Lord raised from the dead, that is like unto me. And the Lord gave me extra time, because 19 years ago, when I was lying on that gurney in Plantation Hospital, the doctors told me not to have another baby. But because of my faith and my hope in God, my daughter, the year after, I got pregnant again, and she's 19 years old. So today I want you to just stop, and I want you to think about your life. If you are not serving the Lord Jesus Christ, I promise the Lord that every time that I would stand before in a pulpit and I would stand before his people, I will ask that question. If you know the Lord as your personal Savior, if you know the Lord as your personal Savior, do you know the Lord today as your personal Savior? If you don't know the Lord as your personal Savior, do not let this day pass you by. Do not let this moment pass you by. Do not let this moment pass you by. Because January 19th, as I said earlier, no one could have told Charlie that he would not live past January 20th. So it were remiss of me not to ask this question today. I would not stand here and not ask this question one more time. You can raise your hand if you don't know the Lord as your personal Savior. I just want you to stand with me if you were a friend of Charlie. I want you to stand. Anybody here that was a friend of Charlie, I want you to stand. Anybody here that was a cousin to Charlie, I want you to stand. Anybody here that was a business partner to Charlie, I want you to stand. Anybody in this room, in this church today that loved Charlie, I want you to stand. So even as I say this morning that I wish above everything that you prosper and be in good health, I want to thank the Lord for each and every one of you today. I want to bless God for each and every one of you today. I want you to just lift your hands in this sanctuary and say, glory, hallelujah. Come on, somebody, because we know that the God that we serve, I want you to give him a clap offering in this house today. Come on, somebody. I want you to clap unto God on today. I want you to lift up the name of Jesus, because he's worthy to be praised. He's worthy to be honored. And so I just thank Besentia. I don't want to start calling names, but you know every person, Debbie, Jackie, in your respectful places, and to my co-laborer, the Reverend, I know that today is a day that the Lord has made. We want to rejoice and be glad in it. I know it's not easy. My dad passed on 2019. My mom passed 2022. But I want to tell you that because I know that we serve a mighty God, because I know that we serve a God who is truly a maker, today is the day that the Lord has made. And so let us lift up the name of Jesus. As we close, I want you to say the name of Jesus. Come on, somebody, let's say Jesus in this place. Come on, let's say hallelujah in this place. Come on, let's say hallelujah one more time. It's the highest praise, and we just thank God, we bless God, and we thank you. Glory to God, hallelujah. These are my few words in the name of Jesus. Heavenly Father, I thank you today, Lord God, even as I cover this family, Lord God. This is not by chance or happenstance that we have come together one more time, God. Father, you know each and every person at the sound of my voice. And so, God, I just pray in the name of Jesus that you will bless them, God. God, you know what each and every person stands in need of as they're sitting there, standing there at the sound of my voice. And so, God, we know that you are Jehovah Rapha, their healer. We know, Father God, that you are Jehovah Jireh, their provider. God, we know that you are Jehovah Shalom, the peace that passeth all understanding. God, we know grief will break families, but we know grief can make families. So, God, I pray for unity among this family, God. I pray, Lord God, because you are the comforter, that you'll comfort their heart in the time of the passing of their loved one. And so, God, I thank you that what you have put together in this family, Lord God, let no man put asunder. And so, God, I ask your blessings on them as they go forth now, God. Comfort them, Lord God. Keep them in the palm of your nail-pierced hands. And so, God, I just thank you. I praise you. I magnify and I lift up your name, dear God. And so we just ask your blessings now as we continue, God, to look to the hills from whence cometh our help. Our help cometh only from you, God, because you are the preserver of our soul. We thank you and we praise you as it is in Jesus' mighty name that we pray. Come on, somebody. Let's say glory, hallelujah. We bless God. We bless God.
Let us stand together as we sing the hymn, Precious Lord, Take My Hand.
Just know.
Please remain standing for the committal, commendation, and the recession. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who have faith in me shall live even though they die, and no one who lives and has faith in me shall ever die. If we live, we live to the Lord. If we die, we die for the Lord. So whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord." The Lord says, "Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead and now I'm alive forevermore. I hold the keys of death and death's domain." O God, who gives us life and in whose arms we die, we now entrust Ernest Constantine Hines to your safekeeping in the faith of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Receive one of your own, one in whom you have been at work, who carries with him our love. Welcome him into your presence, into the rest of everlasting peace, and into the company of all the saints. Living God, in the mystery of your eternity, we know we are not separated from your Son Ernest Constantine, for your love holds us together. While we live, he will not be forgotten among us. In your eternal rest, he will never be lost. May our memories of him enrich our lives, and may the good things of his life leave a trace on earth. Now that the earthly life of Ernest Constantine Hines has come to an end, we commit his body to be cremated, confident of resurrection to life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. He will wipe away all tears from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be any mourning or crying or pain, for the former things have passed away. They shall never again feel hunger or thirst. The sun shall not heat on them, nor any scorching heat, because the Lamb, who is at the heart of the throne, will be their shepherd and will guide them to the springs of the water of eternal life. And God will wipe away all tears from their eyes. Lord, support us by your grace through all the hours of life's day until the shadows lengthen, the busy world is hushed, the fever of life is over, and evening comes. Then, Lord, in your mercy, grant us a safe lodging, a holy rest, and peace at the last, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Go forth upon your journey from this world. Go forth in peace, in the name of the one who created you, in the name of Jesus Christ who suffered for you, in the name of the Holy Spirit who strengthened you. May angels and archangels and all the armies of the heavenly host come to meet you, and may your portion be in gladness and peace, your dwelling and in paradise with God. Go forth upon your journey. And the blessings of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, rest, remain, and abide with us all, and with all of God's children everywhere, both now and forevermore. Amen. Please remain standing as we invite the pallbearers to come forward. The ministers will lead the recession. followed by the pallbearers carrying the remains of Ernest Constantine Hines. Then the members of the family will come immediately behind the pallbearers. And the family is inviting all who are present to a repast at the Footprints Cafe, Footprints Cafe, 5 Belmont Road, Kingston 5. That's the Footprints Cafe, 5 Belmont Road, Kingston 5. The reception.